policy 36 is grateful to manage students' statistics for engineering, or just the data analysis course. And this is the plan for today's class. It's a long slot, 3 hours. I tried to get that changed. I tried to get this room changed because this uphill thing doesn't work so well. But we'll deal with the 3 hour thing and just split it up with lots of breaks. And so this is the rough plan for today. We'll go through the background and the administrative stuff in the you've got in the handout there. And I'll focus primarily on the visualization section, class one. I don't think we'll get to class two at all today, but if it's time permitting, I will definitely try to just show you the software also. I'd like to just start off and acknowledge a few people. The MACC, the McMaster Cooperative Consortium, is a subgroup in the Chemistry Department. Dr. Schwab, Dr. Demarsha Schwab, Prashant Mashkar, Tom Marlin, they're all part of the MACC. And in particular, Dr. John Greger is an emeritus faculty there. This course is what he used to teach for many years. And since he's retired from McMaster, I was asked to teach it this year, and I'm very happy to be here to teach it. But just so if you're aware, a lot of the material in this course is based on his ideas, and you'll see that coming through. And then also I'd like to just mention the other faculty and staff and students who helped me with the materials for this course and given time and advice and so on. Like I said, I definitely want to make it worth your while. It's going to be a very practical course, as you'll see when you go through the handout. There's lots of hands-on work with the computer. But what I'm focusing on a lot is industrial relevance. So I've worked for a number of years outside the university doing this sort of thing for big companies. And I thoroughly enjoy it. And I hope to show some of the relevance of the tools you're learning, because this course is really just a collection of tools for data analysis. So I hope to show you how those tools can be used on real data sets. And so you'll be working with some actual data from chemical industry and elsewhere. So I really want to make it practical and design. There's six major sections of the course, and I'll go through them in a minute. But then beyond those six sections, there's also these enrichment topics that I hope to cover. These are not in the course syllabus, so they're not examinable. And often, I won't have time to cover them, but they'll be in the printed notes for you to go through. Things like robust methods, cross-validation. And these topics here, missing data handling, these are all more of what's really becoming important these days. If you read any of the current research on data analysis, data mining, these are the topics that are discussed in the current research. So I hope to just bring some of that in as well throughout the six sections. So let's just go through what the six sections are. So today's class is data visualization, and it's pretty simple stuff. It's really not complicated at all. It's looking at data tables, time series plots, box plots, bar plots, and how can we effectively show our data to each other, and how can we show our data so that we can learn from it more readily. So we'll cover that in a lot of detail this class. But for the next five sections, I'll just give some examples so you can see where this course is heading by the end. The class after this one, we'll get into this topic of univariate data analysis. And we'll probably spend about 2 weeks in this topic. Two classes of 3 hours. This is really a review of what is the prerequisite for this course. There is a statistics prerequisite for this course, but as some people have mentioned to me, that was a long time ago, or they didn't really take a good statistics course. Whatever your case is, these classes are put in here so that we can kind of get everyone together at the same level. But again, it's not just going to be showing you what means and standard deviations and that sort of stuff. We're going to really look into the details of what it means, how you interpret it. We'll show it on real data sets. Then we'll look into some of the probability distributions, just a quick recap of the sample limit theorem as well. And then we'll look at things like significance testing. So a good example of this is you're currently running your process and you're buying your polymer from DuPont. So DuPont sells you polymer grade X. and they come to you and say, you know, you've been using this now for 3-4 years in your lines. We've got this new formulation on the Y. It should work the same for you, but it's got a number of different properties that we believe are beneficial. We'll lead to stronger product at the end, say, or they'll have some sort of story there, why you want to use it. So you say, okay, well, let me try it. You've got a spare line, spare capacity. You take a delivery of some demo product. So you run sample Y through your process for a period of time. How do you compare whether sample X or sample Y led to any improvement? Why is that important, right? Because if you're running sample X for the past 2-3 years, you're measuring lab values every day, say, one lab sample a day. But those lab samples are not just a flat line, because when you're running polymer X in the process, there's disturbances. People are making other changes to the process. There's temperature changes, there's equipment failures and breakdowns. So every day, while you're running your original polymer X, there's fluctuations and variance. Now when you switch over to polymer Y, there's different fluctuations and variance. So this idea here of testing for significant differences is, how do we test that the new polymer from DuPont really benefited? And it wasn't just a chance movement in the fluctuations in the data. So that's where we'll look at some of that, and then we'll move on to confidence intervals and some of those ideas that you shouldn't have in previous courses. Then the third section, this should be one class on its own, is looking at the idea of process monitoring or control charts. This is not process control like you did in the other 400 elective or the 300 level course. This refers to control in the sense of monitoring your process and making sure it remains controlled. Not looking at feedback. That's a different concept. This is called SPC, statistical process control. And we're looking at Schuler charts, QC charts. These are all graphical tools to make sure our process is still behaving properly. So an example over here is, say you're in charge of a wastewater treatment plant in Burlington. And every day you have, or maybe every 6 hours, you have lab samples of ammonia, of the nitrates, of the substrate levels in your wastewater system. In order to make sure your plant is not deviating from where you'd like it to be, you need to know when these deviations occur. So the easiest way is every 6 hours you get a new data point in your lab. You plot it up on a chart, and you track these charts. And so if you ever looked at photos of a control room or of an operator's room, you'll see all these charts of data that they have. And we'll look at how you construct those charts, and what do they mean, and how do you act on them when you see problems in the charts. And then we'll also look at what each of these charts do. So the Schuler chart is used in a different situation than the EWMA. Now, the fourth section is a pretty standard statistics section on least squares, but I'll go through it by first introducing correlation. Okay, so there's correlation, and then we'll move over to covariance. And I'll use those two ideas of correlation and covariance to introduce least squares. Very often, people just kind of go into the least squares equations and they derive X transpose X inverse, X transpose Y, as you may recall from other courses. But we really see where that comes from by looking at correlation and covariance first. And then you'll just look at the two variable problem. So when you've got one X variable and you're relating it to another Y variable. So that's the bivariate regression problem, the two variable regression. And we'll look at things like analysis of variance, confidence intervals, prediction intervals. And really, what do those least squares assumptions mean? You may recall from your other courses, when you've done least squares, they say, well, we assume the errors are normally distributed, or the Y variable has continuous constant variance. What does that mean, and does it apply to us, right? Some of our processes may violate those assumptions. So we'll check for those and look at what that means. Then we'll move on to the case where there's more than two variables. And then I've just called this additional topics, things like analysis of the residuals and so on. We'll cover that in the end. And also topics of correlation and causation, and then importantly, how do you interpret the software's output? A little bit smaller than that last issue of it. How do you read the software output from statistical packages like Excel and R and so on? Just an example of where this could be used is, say, coming back to a continuous process like, say, Petro-Canada. The timeline from where the raw materials come in the process and then leave at the end is pretty long. So can you, or even if you just take one unit, like a distillation tower, when you make changes at the beginning, it takes a while for it to feed out to the end. So not only do you have that time delay, but also to take the lab measurement and process it can take up to 6 hours to a day sometimes. So even though I can measure all the things pretty much in real time on my process on the distillation column, I can measure the temperatures, the heat input, and so on, pretty much in real time. But how I can't get the values from the lab in real time. I have to wait sometimes up to a day for that. So these correlation tools that are used is you use the real-time data as X variables to predict that output. So that you don't have to wait a day to find out that, well, hang on, my production was off target. You can make changes preemptively and avoid that time delay. So that's one way, one place where you could use this. Okay, so those first four sections really would take us up to the first half of this course. Probably not quite up to the midterm, but probably just after the midterm, we'll finish all of that. Then the next two sections, DOEs and latent variable methods, are really kind of the application section of this course. This is where I think you'll have the most fun in seeing how these tools that we've developed in the first half of the course really start to work for you. So in DOEs, we'll start off here, randomization and blocking. I'll explain what those concepts are and why they're important. Then we'll look at factorial designs. Well, firstly, let's just step back. How many of you are familiar with DOEs, design of experiments, and that concept? Okay, so let me just quickly explain. DOEs, for example, IKEA has this new chair that they released last year. I forget the name, but it's made from 50% recycled plastic and 50% sawmill waste, so wood fibers. I've worked with people in Toronto that are working on these materials. And what they do is, what they're interested in, is they're interested in modeling the breakability, or the strength. So it's some sort of strength characteristic of this plastic. So what IKEA does is, their manufacturers, they'll find these wood fiber composites, say from a sawmill up in Quebec, and they get aspen or fir or pine. They'll blend these fibers that are finely chopped up in with the plastic. So if you've taken, I don't know who teaches the polymer course these days in Cambridge, but you probably have heard or seen twin screw extruders. Anyone? Twin screw extruders? Okay. So they'll blend these wood fibers up with the plastic, and they'll add a binding agent to it as well. And they want to characterize the final strength of this product. So what is done is here in the DOE fashion they identify various factors. So the wood fiber size. So they've got two lots of wood fibers, small wood fibers, big wood fibers. That's one factor. Another factor is the temperature at which they run the twin screw extruder. Low temperature, high temperature, say. The third factor will be the binding agent. Low concentration, high concentration, and so on. So in this example, there's five. The screw speed, binding agent, dimensions of the fibers, the feed ratio, and the temperature of the extruder. So you've got five factors, each low, high, low, high. If you take all the combinations of that, there's 2 to the power of 5, 32 different combinations of those low, high factors. And you run those 32 experiments in your lab in random order. So that's the randomization topic of that. You run them in random order, and we'll explain when we get to the section why you must do that. And you then quantify that quantify that strength variable. So you've got this data of the different factors you vary, and then one column of numbers for the 32 experiments of the polymer strength, the polymer wood fiber composite strength. And from that, you can use the data. That's where the analysis part comes. So the design first says, how do we run these experiments? The analysis part says, okay, let's analyze the data, and then find the settings that lead to best strength, and understand why that happens. So that's what BOE is about, and sometimes there's too many factors, so we run what's called fractional factorials, where you do, say, one half of the runs, or one quarter of the runs. And we still can find a good amount of information from just that fractional factorial. And we'll look at topics of that, and then how, say you do go, say your boss is really happy with the first 8 experiments you run, and he gives you time and money to run the next 8 experiments, the next fractional factorial. How can you combine fractional factorials with each other? And the reason why this is, you're doing this course is you're going to do a project on this as well, and I'll help you talk about that when we get to the grading section. And then the last section in this topic is response surface measures, where you use these tools to continually optimize the process. Okay, and then I hope to have about 3 weeks left at the end and cover this topic, latent variable methods. This is one of my passions. This is what I do for a living in my other time, part of my time, is work on these tools. And latent variable methods are really important for industry these days. I'll explain when we get to that section of the course, but you really can't rely on some of the traditional methods that like least squares and so on to do data analysis anymore, because our data sets are just so big. So the latent variable methods really are an effective tool to deal with modern data sets and to really extract the value from that data. So One example of this is, say, a batch reactor. If you're developing drugs, say, in Amgen, a big move is away from just standard tableting drugs that are produced in a lab, but now to move to cellular drugs that are produced inside a cell, inside an organism. So you have your batch culture develop sometimes up to 30 days. And then you empty out that reactor from the cells, you harvest the cells, and you break them open. And part of the byproducts of the cellular mechanism is to produce a drug, say, that treats Alzheimer's or some sort of other disease. So there's a big trend to move to those drug development cycles. But those batch reactors produce a huge amount of data. Firstly, there's the data about what you put into the reactor. So you've got all sorts of characteristics about your raw materials. And then when you run the reactor and turn it on, you've got temperature, pressure, oxygen demand, impeller speed, impeller torque, and all sorts of variables you're measuring over time, for 30 days sometimes. And maybe you've got a sample every 5 minutes on 20 variables for 30 days. These matrices grow into megabytes and gigabyte size. And trying to look at anything in these data using the concepts that you've learned in traditional statistical tools, it's not going to work for you. And to my knowledge, this McMaster is the only university in Canada that teaches this sort of stuff at the undergraduate level. I looked at the course outlines for a similar course like this. None of the other schools teach multivariate data methods at all in their undergraduate level, which I think is a real shame, because when you leave here and start to work with data, these tools are going to be very applicable. So we'll look at principal components analysis. That's really the basic tool of any latent variable method. Principal components regression takes that a step further as a replacement for least squares regression. And then I'll just point out some other applications related to drug discovery, fire development, and batch and image data analysis. Okay. So any questions up to this point? You're all excited about the class? I know it's an elective, you've chosen to be it, so you've got to be. Right, so, okay, before you get all too excited, let's go through the details like grades. You might decide to go to this course. Let's hope that. Firstly, just an announcement. If you're interested in graduate studies, Chemical Engineering is hosting this grad preview event next month, 18th to 20th of February. I think it's during that reading retreat. So it's a chance to meet faculty and grad students and find out more about what grad studies are like. The application deadline for that is this Friday. And if you apply, the application is all electronic, but you go to CHE grad preview on the conference here. And there's a link on the Cambridge website to that as well. So if grad studies is something that you might be interested in doing next year, after your fourth year, it might be worth your while. Of course, this is actually a Canada-wide thing. This is to invite students from other universities and other provinces to McMaster. So for you guys, you're already here, you can chat to any of the professors and grad students at any time, but this is a more formal event where there's dinners and poster sessions and so on involved. You need to find out more. Okay, the other thing I want to mention early on is this class is being recorded. There's a video camera at the back. The purpose is for you to be able to go after the class and review the course notes. Maybe you missed a class because you were sick. It's really there for you also to prepare perhaps for assignments in advance. Just to point out from a privacy point of view, no one is being recorded except the front of the class. In fact, it doesn't even get your heads. So, but if anyone does have an objection to that, just come speak to me and I'll try to make an arrangement for you. I can't guarantee it's going to be any good. It's a really just an ordinary home video camera. The sound quality may not be that great, but I'll try to get it up on the website within 24 hours. The other electronic thing about the course is that everything is through the website. So the website stands for .eng.mcmaster.ca. Everything is there. Any announcements that I'll be making will go there. Assignments go there, data sets, and so on. There's also a forum on the website. This is different to the online learning, what's it, CLT or WebCT or something that the university has. This is an alternative to that for you to interact with your classmates on the forum, so I'll talk about that later. And the video is also going to be up there. Just so that you... this is what the course website looks like. So it's a standard wiki, and today's class is available here under visualizing data. I'll actually still put the introduction course overview up later this evening or tomorrow. And then there's the other sections of the course. So those red links will become blue kind of as I prepare the notes. And the data sets for the course are up here on the right, and there, rather, there's a course calendar and the forums. Link is over there. And then further down is the assignments section. So assignment for today is already posted. The solutions will be posted afterwards. And so take a look at that on your own time afterwards. Okay, regarding the textbook, there were a number of good textbooks that I could have chosen from. But what happens with a course like this, which is just a collection of different tools, is that one textbook is good for two, three sections, and then another textbook is good for another. So there wasn't really one book I could find that would work for the whole course. So there isn't a recommended or a mandatory text that you need at all. On the website and on the handout here in front of you there, I do mention three books, and one of them is Box Hunt and Hunter, this guy. So it's $150, I think Amazon.ca has got it for $124. I don't know if the bookstore is matching that. But if you do, I recommend buying it if you're going to buy one book for this course. And if you're the type of person who buys a book and then returns it to the bookstore afterwards, don't bother. But if you do want to buy a book that you're going to keep with you that's useful, this is the one I do recommend, because the authors here really put in a lot of their practical experience with these data methods. It focuses mostly on the DOE part, the type of statistics for experimenters. It focuses a lot on the DOE side of the course, but there's also parts on linear regression and confidence intervals and tests and so on in the earlier chapters. So I do recommend that. And take a look at it. It's on reserve in the library before you buy it. You might just want to check it out. And I am giving a copy of it away to someone who's more creative than I am that can design a logo to go in this little box over here. So if by the end of the month, if you can give me a good logo to go there, you get a copy of the book. Okay, more software. Data analysis, computers, they go together. If you're uncomfortable with computers and you don't know, have a phobia for it, this may not be the right place for you. But you're going to need it for the assignments and the take-home exams. And I was just talking about earlier to some of the people in front, and apparently take-home exams are not common or in engineering, so this might be a first for you guys from that point of view. But there will be a section of the course where you have to write an exam at home on the computer. We'll be using R. Now, I don't know if some of you have used R before in the second year, is that right? Yeah. How did you guys find it? I see shaking hands. It's not good. Any strong points of view? You didn't enjoy it? You found it hard? Was it because it's a programming language and not a graphical user interface? Like, would you be more comfortable with something like Excel or VTab? Okay. Because my reasons for using R are, firstly, it's becoming far more widely used. Over here is a cover shot from the New York Times in January 2009. And you don't get the New York Times writing about Microsoft Excel and other software packages, but they wrote about R. It's used by, those are the two founders, but it's used by Google, Merck, Bank of America, Shell, and so on. And as they say here, it's the name of a popular programming language used by a growing number of data analysts inside corporations and academia, and is becoming the lingua franca because it's entered a golden age. Used to set ad prices, find new drugs, fine-tune financial models, and so on. It really is becoming the language to use if you're doing any serious data analysis. I have a little bit of a hang-up with these point-and-click software interfaces like Excel and Minitab. The reason why I have a hang-up with them, yes, it's easier to use, it's easy to get kind of where you want to go. But if you ever need to redo your analysis, a week later, your colleague asks you, well, what if we change this parameter? What if we redo the analysis that way? You've forgotten the order in which you pointed and clicked. With R, is you've got the code there, you can rerun it on the same data set, you can go change parameters, you can go put in a new data set and verify that your findings are still accurate. It's far more methodical from that point of view. Similar to MATLAB, in the way that you write a little script to do your data analysis. To be honest, the R is the software used for the course, but there's no penalty for using anything else. If you want to use Minitab or Excel, and I really don't recommend Excel, but if you do want to use Minitab or something else, say you want to code it up in Python or you want to do it in MATLAB, by all means. I'm not interested in what the tool that you use, I'm interested in you showing your results and how you got to the final solution. So even for the take-home exam, you don't need to provide R code to show me how you did your steps. You just need to show me how you got to your solution, whether you did it in another software package. It's covered on it. But I will be using R in the classes to show some things. I will be putting a screencast. I'll be putting a little section on the website that shows you how to download and install it. It's available in the fourth year labs, not in the undergraduate labs, but in the fourth year Cambridge lab, it's there already. And I'll show you some example scripts. So I hope it's not too much of a hang-up. I think what usually the hang-up comes from these programming languages that they kind of just say, go use R, and what you go do is you go recycle previous R code from friends, or someone does assignment one and everyone goes and copies that code, and you don't never really understand why you've done certain things in the language. So to help that, for example, on the website, it's not available yet, but I'll make it that if you click on any of the images on the course website, it will then bring up the R code used to generate that image. So you kind of get a feeling for how to do certain things. And I'll provide example scripts to do that. So I hope it makes it a bit more comfortable using it. But I really, I'm quite happy to use R for these reasons listed here. But particularly because it promotes this good statistical practice. And it also doesn't hurt that it's free. And secondly, or thirdly, it runs on all platforms, Windows, Linux, and Mac. Whereas something like Linux is Windows only. So the classes, I'll structure them. We'll start off usually with a short quiz. It's very low stakes, as you'll see when I come to the grading. It's really not going to penalize you at all if you miss the quiz. Then you'll hand in any assignments, and then we'll have the class and break it up in lots of sections to just get a bit of a breather and so on. Please bring a calculator or a tiny laptop to the class. There are no electrical outlets in this class at all. So just bring whatever you bring, just make sure that you can run it with batteries. And then just bring extra paper for the bottom. Okay, let me introduce the TA. Masood is standing up at the back. Masood is the TA for this course. He was the TA for this course last year, so he has experience with this material. Masood is also doing his PhD in multivariate data analysis with John McGregor and Matt Mashkar. So this sort of stuff is well within his area. And his contact information is on the handout. Now, I would just like to get to know a bit better what your expectations are for office hours. When is a good time? Like Monday is out of the equation, but Tuesdays, Wednesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays. Which days suit you best for office hours? Let's take a look at Tuesday mornings. Okay, Tuesday afternoons. You guys know your timetable here for this semester? Okay, so Tuesday mornings, as I work for 1, 2, 3 people. Okay, Tuesday afternoons. Wednesday mornings. Wednesday afternoon. Okay, that's just in the morning. Thursday morning. Friday. Thursday afternoon, sorry. Friday morning. Friday afternoon. Okay, how many people does Thursday afternoon not work for? Okay, 1 or 2. So, okay, so we'll probably arrange the office hours for Thursday afternoon. And for those of you that really can't make it at that time, you can email and make an appointment somewhere else. But I'll talk with the student, you'll find a time slot in their location, and I'll post it on the website for that. So that's Thursday afternoon. So just regarding questions and assignments and so on outside the course, the expectation I have from you is, well, the expectation you can have from the student and I is that we'll promptly respond to emails. Please use the McMaster email address for myself, DUNNKG, and please send from your McMaster emails. I really can't answer emails from non-McMaster email addresses, just because we've got email filters set up that way. So. But firstly, before you email the pseudo I, would you please use the forum and ask each other? That way, you guys can help each other out. And it's also a good way just to keep, for me to see what the problem areas are in the class. So it's publicly available over there for you to ask each other questions. And then email the TA or myself after that. Or arrange some face-to-face meeting. So we'll set Thursday afternoons then. And I'll take a look if I can use JHM 342. If that's free, then we'll set it over there for the office hour. Okay, now the topic of the course. I really want from the grading, it's to, for you to demonstrate that you understand the concept. I think every instructor wants that. But the ability to show that you can apply this to new instances is going to be more critical. This is the first time I'm teaching this course. I've taught courses like this to industrial vendors on six or several occasions in Canada and Europe and the US. So this sort of teaching thing is not, I've done it with industry. In industry, you can't give them the assignments and exams. They don't do that well. But for you guys, I really want in the assignments for you to show me that you can apply it to new concepts. The reason why I mentioned I'm teaching it the first time is because there's no past exams or tests for you to go back and to see what I am or what my style is. But I can tell you what my style is. My style is I read lots of newspapers and magazines and I ask questions from those. So you'll get concepts from current world affairs, from bioengineering, from financial markets. Anywhere where there's data is where I'll be asking questions from. And the reason why I do that is because those same concepts are applicable in chemistry. The same, they use the same tools. Least squares wasn't developed in chemical engineering. Like all these tools are used in all sorts of other areas. So sometimes you will be getting questions from those areas to look at. So I'd like you to think about how you can use these tools to these other instances, and then think about different ways of solving problems. Because this course on data analysis, there's no right way or wrong way to analyze a data set. I mean, there's blatantly, obviously wrong ways to do things. But when it comes to the right way, there's several alternatives. So please be creative in any way you like to show me different ways that you can think about the problem rather than just recycling the source code. Regarding the breakdown of the marks, firstly is the sum of the breakdown adds up to 105%. So anyone scoring above 100 will still get 100%. But that 5% room is mainly there for the in-class quizzes. So that 5% over there is really why it bumps it up to 105. As I said, the quizzes are really just a way for me to gauge was the class prior to the one effective. Like, did I convey the material well? Did you understand the topics? So it's not there to penalize it, because you don't need to learn the material from the class today and have it thoroughly understood by the next class, right? It may only sink in by the time the midterm comes by or the final exam. So that's why there's no penalty for the quizzes, but for those of you that do participate in the quizzes, it's a great way for me to see that things are on target or not, and where I need to come back to. The assignments, there should be about 8 of them. Please do them in groups of 4 or less. I really am focusing strongly on the group work in this course. You can get up to 60% of the grade from coursework. 40% is on your own. 40% comes from the written final exam and the written midterm. So that everything else is group work, and groups up to 4. Please, when you group things in group, just put all your group members' names. Even the take-home portion of the exam, you can do in groups and collaborate. You still have to hand in individual exams, but you just say, okay, for this exam, I discussed topics on this exam with X, Y, and Z. So there's a lot of group work for the assignments, for the projects will be in groups, and yeah, as I said, the only part that's by itself is the final exam and the midterm written portion. The take-home exam is there for you to do stuff that you can't do in the written exam. You can use the R software or any other software package. You'll be analyzing data that may take you a day or two to get through the questions. So the take-home exam is typically run over a 4-day period. I'll hand it out on a Monday, it's due on Thursday. And then the final exam will be a standard 3-hour exam. And it will cover all the material from the course. Okay, so that just recaps what I said there. The reason for the group work is really, it's far more effective that you learn with each other, because if you've got a problem that you're facing, there's other people in your group that you can work with to get through that. And it's far more effective to do that than to just come see me and get the answer. Just to discuss. So please work in groups. I really am strongly encouraging you in this course. The only thing that with groups is it gets a little bit messy when I don't have it here now. Is say there's four questions and there's four group members. My preference is that you don't do the strategy where person one does question one, person two does question two, three, four, because you're kind of defeating the object of the group work. With the group work, the way I would like you to do it is that after the assignment's posted, you meet with your group, you discuss the questions, or you discuss basic concepts. So then you go and do it separately and then come back together and iterate with each other. And maybe meet up once again and then hand in a group assignment. Then you can write up, okay, person one can be responsible for writing up question one. But that you've all actually gotten through all the questions. Not that you only do question one and you don't bother with two, three, and four. You're just not learning that way, right? So that's what I would like for you to do with the group work. But also when you hand in assignments, we'll take the hand in when the group's assignment comes in. If question four is not attached because the fourth group member hasn't handed it in, we can't accept late assignments coming from different people and figuring out where the pages go and with which assignment. So once the assignment's handed in, that's it. So just arrange with the group to deal with that. Also, being a big class and one TA, the point of assignments is that you learn from them, right? So you have the class today, you get the assignment, you hand it in next week. We want to hand that assignment back to you the week after, so there's a 2-week delay. In order to get through all that marking, we really need them handed in on time. So there's a severe penalty if you hand it in late. But we do realize that things come up, so there's a 2-day late day credit. So you can hand in one assignment 2 days late, or you can hand in two assignments 1 day late, and you won't have any penalty. But after that, you'll be penalized. So also, there's no makeups for the assignments and quizzes, and we'll only take the best. Say if there's 8 assignments, we'll only use the best 6 to form that 20% of the assignment. Okay, is the grading issue pretty clear? Was there any questions? Something I didn't explain. Okay. I mentioned this about the take-homes. You can collaborate. The written exam will be open notes. You can bring whatever materials you like to the class, to the exam. It's obviously not in your favor to have huge books, especially if we have the exam in this class. I'll try to arrange it to be in a different class because these tables are too small. But you can bring whatever you like. Just don't bring cell phones and other communication devices. Okay, the course calendar is on the website, but I'm just pointing it out here for you so you can plan for the semester. The take-home is the 1st of February, June the 4th. Then there's the in-class exam on the 8th of February. That's just before the reading week. Then I think reading week is the week of the 15th to the 20th. You'll have that week free. There won't be any assignments. There won't be any anything from my side during the reading week. That's going to take a break. Then the 29th of March, there'll be a take-home final, and that's due the 1st of April because the university then has a ban on any further testing apart from the 2nd of April. So 1st of April, the final is due, the take-home portion of the final is due, and then the 5th of April will be the last class, and then sometime in April will be the final exam. Just not sure. These dates are all on the calendar, on the webpage, sorry. Okay, so the university has a lot of rules and regulations regarding appropriate group work. There is also the whole website on academic honesty that you should be aware of, and the website is listed there in the handout. But for this course, what I mean by appropriate group work is what I just described there earlier, where you have an equal share of responsibility to do any group sort of work, so whether it's the group assignment or the group project. I really hope not to have to deal with issues where group members come and complain to me that group member X is not contributing. I would prefer not to deal with those sorts of things. So right up front, I'm just stating it here. This is what I expect from group work, that you jointly plan your group exercise and that you're all responsible for making sure that you hand in your portion of the group work in on time and then submitting a group assignment on time. And then, as I didn't mention it here, but please put on the assignment, of course, every group member's name and on the exam handings and the project handings. Also, an example of inappropriate group work is direct posting of solutions on the forums or any other electronic website. There was that issue at York University a few years ago, I'm sure you're aware of that, the students doing those sort of things. So you're free to discuss concepts in the course about the assignments, but please don't say, this is the answer to question one and post it up. That would be important. Okay.